getting him.
Yeah, he's a little bit on my fringe, too. Hello, Wrench. Hello, your name just went right out of my head. Rick. Ranger Rick.
What's going on, Spitfire? How you doing, Spitfire?
What's going on?
Warming up the radio here and seeing if it still works. It seems to work. Sounding good on this end. Known as the Browning Mark I.
Solid state. Regency, formula 23.
October 29.
Using a stock mic on that?
Yeah, why? Is it low?
No, it just sounds like a stock mic. It's like you're holding your nose.
Oh no!
Oh no! Oh man!
Well, this is a Galaxy microphone.
Yeah, it's working. It just has that stock mic sound to it. It's not, it's loud enough and all, it's just the tone.
Says gracias for 29 classic. Oh, two Cobra 29s. What was that? I said that's what the Ranger has also. He run in the classic? I think that's what he said he had.
Just the regular Cobra 29. Now this is the Cobra coffin style bike.
And it's Hatfield and.
Better? How about that?
I fixed it.
Ten four Buffalo Bob, we got a copy on you. Sparky waving down your way. Good evening. Okay, then I guess we're doing it live and on Spew Radio.
Live, worldwide, on Spew Radio.
Roger that.
Yeah, man, you're on the video gate. The video gate's rolling right now. So you got Spew Radio and the video gate to look forward to later. It's time for the roundup. Monkey man, look what you did.
Yeah, I'll tell you, it was 2 weeks ago. I don't remember, it was in here, yeah, 2 weeks, I think. Well, maybe it was three, I don't know. I think it was Banger and I just at first, and it was kind of quiet, and I kind of joked that as soon as I clammed up, you know, everybody else would key up, and yeah, sure enough, that's how it worked out.
Hey, Monkey Man, this is Wrench. Hey, what's your 20?
Hey, Wrench. I'm over here. Well, geez, I call it the northwest end. Kind of over here below, like, where the old giant supermarket used to be. Well, kind of near where the new one is.
Are you over by, like, Tractor Supply?
Yes, sir.
Roger.
I just was looking at your pics you put up today with the new antenna setup.
Yeah, I got the base antenna up a little higher. All I gotta do now is just drill the ground out and sink the pole down, and then run the grounding rod down through, hit the grounding connector, and then we'll be good to go.
Yeah, there you go. You got it way up there, man. You got a lot of height down to that.
Yeah, I used three 10-foot, 10.5-foot poles, and then the antenna itself is, 21, 28 feet, I think, is the IMAX. So, yeah, it put me up there pretty high. Yeah, the wife and I were just joking about that, about, you know, possibly having to put a beacon light on her for the helicopters from the hospital.
Yeah, there you go. Better safe than sorry.
Yeah, no kidding.
It's time now for Classic Radio Roundup. Flat.
Really low.
Better? Great care?
A little better. Its tone quality sucks, but the audio level is fine.
So the last microphone was better?
Yeah, this one really sounds like you're pinching your nose.
Might be just the radio in general. Good evening, Monkey Man wanted to wave. Triple B over here.
Hey, right back at you. What's going on?
Living that Browning dream.
I can't hear it.
Ranger, that's one of those old Cobra 29s, right? 23 channel?
Yeah, 10-4.
Yeah, it might be in the radio. Do we sound all pinched off or anything? Like the other guys coming through, or does it sound normal? I meant the Rangers radio, that's all.
Nah, it sounds a little off. I was thinking where it was sitting, maybe. I could put an external on there.
Yeah, the frequency seems pretty close. Channel 13 radios.
Yeah, we found it and we're leaving it there.
I just saw a joke on Facebook I gotta do sometime. It's pretty funny.
Put a pin in someone's coax?
No. It says, when I get bored, I call in the sick to places I don't even work at. Tomorrow I'm getting written up at Walmart.
John, this is your third time this week.
Yeah, Monkey Man. Look at that, Monkey Man.
Thank you.
Spitfire.
Countywide.
How out spelled finger?
Making progress. Not 100%, but it's not wrapped anymore.
Don't you hang it when you hate it when you bang it on something?
Doesn't really hurt anymore. It just feels like it's asleep. You know, like tingly. Sensitive. Trying to use it.
Hey Sparky, what kind of Browning did you say you were running?
They call this the Mark 1, but it's a pair of a transmitter and a receiver. It's the Eagle R27 is the receiver, and the Eagle S23 is the AM-only transmitter.
Okay, yeah. Now I'm just doing some Google searching, just looking at what everybody's running. Just getting an idea what these are. Pretty cool.
Regency, Formula 23.
I did the same thing you're doing back then to see what everybody was running. That was pretty cool.
This thing looks like a 1970s tabletop stereo.
You're probably running about the same as I am.
You're all into them vintage stereos and stuff now. You ought to take a look at the antique radio sale in May up at Renninger's. Yeah, May 11th and 12th. It is a candy store. And I'm going up there to sell stuff so I can buy more stuff. Come on.
Oh, I'll stop by and try to haggle with you.
My stuff's too old for what you're looking for. Mine's all vacuum tube stuff.
Oh, I don't really try to talk you down.
I got a really rare one that's going up there for sale. A 1931. All-American Mohawk, Lyric 23, cabinet made by Wurlitzer.
Wurlitzer?
That's who made the cabinet, 10-4.
They do pianos?
Organs and pianos and jukeboxes, yep. They also made radio cabinets back in the day.
10-4. Yeah, didn't the music group Styx used to run Wurlitzers?
I can't answer that question, I don't know.
I would say yes.
I just know there's a big old plate on the cabinet of the radio. It says made by Wurlitzer. Syracuse, New York, 1931.
I'm going to have to remember May 11th till I get downstairs and I can mark it on the calendar.
May 11th and 12th, Friday and a Saturday.
Those people camp out up there, and they have like a bonfire with some old radio carcasses. I've seen them.
Oh, that sounds like sacrilege. What was that monkey man you got stepped on?
That's all right. I should say, if it's Friday and Saturday, it'll be the 12th for me. I have committed it to memory. Now I just gotta hold it there until I get downstairs.
Right, until something else comes along. Squirrel!
If I see something shiny.
That's the problem, you'll see something shiny.
So that's a Thursday, Friday then?
Friday and a Saturday.
Friday is the 12th, Saturday is the 13th.
Well, then it's the 12th and the 13th.
And where'd you say that was at?
Renninger's, up at Kutztown.
Grab a pound of lemon, Blenny, while I'm up there.
to bring my mud duck in a bag, in a cage, or on a leash. Come on.
You can bring the mud duck on a leash. What's going on there, original operator?
Good evening to you, too. And I know there's a few more out there. Sitting at 307 feet pointing at you, Hello Smith.
Just make sure you keep that mud duck on a short leash.
I will return. Hopefully I'll be able to get through the normal noise zone. Hello, goodbye.
Well, thanks for checking in with us here on Classic Radio Roundup. Motor Puppy, the original operator. Look at the clock. It's all early for the train to be pulling into the station. What's going on there, Night Train? Countywide radio.
Well, it's because I got to go to bed early tonight, Tempor.
Well, it happens that way sometimes, I suppose. But there ain't no bed for me tonight. I got to go off to work after this fun.
How's you on that?
How you doing, Train? Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, then I go back into 2 days, Monday, Tuesday, Tuesday, Wednesday, etc.
Somebody with a screwed up schedule worse than mine.
Space.
Roger that.
Somebody got a worse schedule than mine.
Gotta love the prison.
Evening, Train.
Hey, how you doing, Ranger?
Turning green or what?
It's starting. It seems slower than other people's.
Heck, mine's ready to be cut. Need the leaves to come out on the trees and slow that growth down. My grass grows fast until the leaves come out. I ain't doing it today, and I ain't doing it tomorrow.
I don't think there's going to be much outdoor work going on tomorrow with this rain coming in.
Yeah, more rain, that means the grass is going to grow even more by the time I get to it.
Anybody have any idea what time we are to expect rain tomorrow?
All I know is morning and afternoon.
I believe they were saying somewhere around 3, 4 o'clock is supposed to start. 5, 6 o'clock in the morning, it's supposed to be really heavy.
Is that Port of Mexico Cuba Skip coming in there that I hear?
Sounds like Maria's in for the night. Actually, that might be San Diego.
Yeah, I was hearing Delco in there real good for a while, but now I'm hearing other stuff, and it don't sound like Delco. Hello, Rooster, from your countywide radio.
Hey, Rooster, we got a wrench out here. 4,000 guys out there. That's good.
Classic Radio Roundup. Classic Radio Wednesday.
From Bagger tonight?
No, not yet, but there is somebody standing by, I think, wants to break in. Come on in there, standby. Sounding good out this side.
And doggone ping set up the Skype settings. I had to back everything way down. Doggone radio's working fine, but I was afraid the ping was going to overload the audio circuit, but I backed it down to where I think it's working okay. As long as you can understand me, that's all well and good. Anyway, get in there, but I found the frequency. I'm copying the mail. I'm still out here. I'm just me and this old rusty bird. I'll see you.
Hey, Roger, they're sounding good, there, Dr. Hammer, on that rusty bird. No doubt about it. Train on his trashy tram, and I'm back on the side.
That's two rusty birds out here tonight.
Evening, Doc Hammer. Which one you running?
Mark 1. No mark. I should say no mark because it don't have any mark anywhere on it, but it's mark 1. It's the one before the mark 2.
That's so cool, man. You got the memo.
Indeed, I did. I do require a 980. I left you a message on the board. Unfortunately, my computer messed up, so I'm going to have to re-scrounge my login credentials so I can log back in. But I got a little piece of tech info. I'll send you a PM on Facebook about it, about a bug that those radios have. I found it and fixed mine. I don't know if you've had that or not, but anyway, I'll send you a PM and you can figure it out.
Oh, cool. Thanks. Yeah, I haven't been on there much lately, but I will check in from time to time. And I ran a set that's sitting below this set for the first time. I didn't bring it up on a Variac as one of those things. It's like, hey, let's plug it in, see if it works. I got 15 minutes. And plugged it in. It started working. The receive was a little crackly at times. So I switched to a known good one. But they're both the same, right? The 27 and the 23, is that the set?
Roger that. That's actually a hair on wheels talking radio. I used to have a set of those, and I'll guarantee you they're a hair on wheels talking radio. Transmitter's real easy to add extra channels to if you want to. They still have crystals for those.
Well, that one's got good audio, man. Sounded really good. As everybody is. Night train, good evening. Didn't get to say hi, Rooster. Good evening.
Good evening there, Sparky. How you doing?
Living the Browning dream.
I'm doing a dream.
Oh, man.
There's like some tabs on the side of the transmitter for like a card or something. Do you see that, Doc?
Yeah, my old Eagles had that on there. That was for a station ID card, like, you know, the license thing that they used to require that you had back in the day. Those of us old enough to remember those days, there's a few on the channel that remember those. But now we used to have to pay $20 for a license. You used to have to keep it on your station like ham operators do now. No, this is a Golden Eagle. Sparky, this is a Golden Eagle. This is the one after the R27S23.
I think Sandbagger would know the correct answer to this, but wasn't that called SEC Form 5 or something like that? And you had to put that sticker on your radio?
Yeah, I think you're right there, Pete. I think you're right. I never did put my own. Never did I ever own had one of those stickers on. As a matter of fact, any radio I ever bought back in the day, the first thing to the trash can, besides the warranty form, was the FCC application for a license.
Now I got to look around, because I got one of these radios around here has that sticker on it. And I was aware of it, but I had never actually seen one. I'm like, oh, somebody actually stuck that sticker on there.
Yeah, my console too. I have a packet, an information packet came out of a box when I first bought this radio, and included were the instruction manual, the service manual, believe it or not, was part of the owner's manual back then. Then the FCC information and the request for a license and all that good stuff, including 3 or 4 copies of the warranty card to be sent off. I still have an original SBE packet with all that junk in it.
Locations are subject to change. Terms and conditions may apply.
KFS 6662.
KDVO 568 KASS 7775 KATO 3542
Everybody had one. Hard to do, man. That would be funny. Every 10 minutes we put our call sign out there.
I think it was more than that on CB radio, though, wasn't it? Wasn't it every 5 minutes and at the end of every transmission or series of transmissions? I forget now. Something like that, though. It was more strict than AM.
It was fun, though. Nobody really minded. Man, everybody wanted their call letters out there.
I feel left out. I don't have any.
You'll have to make up one.
Yeah, use your initials and your zip code.
What was that, Sparky?
That's Spitfire. Use your initials and your zip code. That's what you used to use for temporary authorization.
Okay, cool.
While you're waiting for your return license from the FCC, you can use your initials and your zip code. Like, well, if I could do that, why can't I just use a handle and forget the whole thing?
Yeah, roger that.
That's where that all came from. Nobody, after a while, like, you're doing all the shenanigans and not following the letter of the law. The heck with telling them who I am.
Yeah, it's crazy. I knew about ham radio having that, but I never heard of CB radios having that.
Yeah. CB radio required a license up until the 1980s at some point. I can't remember exactly when. Late 80s, early 90s. Prior to that, you had to have a license. And in the 60s and 70s, they were pretty strict about it.
You know what? Now that I'm looking at my dad's old picture, on the back of his car, he actually has his call sign. It's KASW7.
You can use that one.
Not enough numbers.
Extra number to
you need 3 or 4 letters and 4 numbers.
Yeah, you must have left some of it off then.
Guess that was his ham call sign.
No, that's not the right format. There's no number. No, that's the wrong format for ham.
Okay.
That was a whole lot of tripling going on. Yeah, it's going back to the 60s.
Showing your age. Including Wrench. Wrench, you must be really young if you can't remember the call sign thing.
I just put my 39th candle on.
He turned forward. Yeah, you young, man.
Oh, that's good to hear.
I was young again.
Yep, youth is wasted on the young.
You never really know.
You do when you get older, you realize that youth was wasted when on your youth. Now I got all these radios I used to look at in the catalog and could never afford. Now I got them.
That's the reward. That's your reward right there, man. Never.
Let alone all these microphones.
Yeah, choice microphones. An array of microphones.
Turner Plus 2, Turner Plus 3, Super Sidekick, CS1, an M Plus 2. Oh, yeah, that's just the start.
Applications are subject to change. Terms and conditions may apply. Limited supplies. Limited supplies.
Terms and conditions apply.
Sounding countywide, this is the first time you heard me on this one.
That's a smooth operator right there.
That's the 201A, but for some reason it just seems a little bit better than some of my others.
How do you like this Regency Formula 23?
Fine. It sounds real good coming through here, man.
That's nice to know. It's a good-looking radio.
I looked that up. What's the number?
Formula 23. Sort of looks like a 70s vintage tabletop radio, you know, regular broadcast radio with the alarm clock and all. It's got a stylish burnished aluminum face with chrome trim and black around and round speaker defined in the front. It looks like a 1970s, you know, tabletop clock radio.
Four on that tabletop clock radio. Transistorized, I take it.
10-4. 23 channel AM radio. It's made around 71, 72.
It sounds nice. What microphone you use with it?
I got a plus 2 on it.
Nice.
It's got a nice big meter, bigger than your average meter.
Got me a big old meter on the front. Got me a big old Hummer.
Yeah. Got me a big old, yeah, big old Hummer. And my wife's got big boobs, and I paid for them. But anyway, yeah, the meter's 2 inches square.
Nice, man. I have a watt meter that's like humongous. I don't know what the size is. I'd say at least 4 inches. It's that Palomar 500.
I got the meter in that makes you feel good. PDC 600. Makes you feel good.
Yeah, I believe I seen that when I was over at your place. The real big one.
It's the triple meter. SWR, Mod, and Power.
All right, that's not the one I'm thinking about. I remember you having a big, gigantic S meter connected to a radio. I mean, this thing was like a sweep dial.
I did. I had, that thing was like 6 inches square or more. My big spy meter. That was hooked up to my TRC 441 that wound up going to Florida by accident with the old 05 and never to be seen again.
That's a shame. Specifications are subject to change. Terms and conditions do apply.
What makes it hurt even more is that was the very first radio I ever bought brand new, and I had it all this time, and then I let him borrow it, not knowing that his whole world was falling apart.
10-4 on that. So you could say he spoiled you then.
Spoiled me?
Yeah, he took the spoil. That's what they did in the days of old, man. After war, then they take all of the goodies from the slain. It was called spoiling.
Well, I was compensated in a way, because a lot of the spoils he left behind, I wound up grabbing.
All right, well, that helps it. It makes you feel better. Little Band-Aid on a sore, 10-4.
Yeah, I was compensated. It still stinks that radio went.
Roger on that, yeah. So that was the 441. Was that the Spitfire?
Yep, Navajo, 441. The Spitfire was my own.
10-4.
That was a three-knob radio that screamed.
I'm sure you prefer being in front of some other radio that, you know, really has a lot to look at, knobs to turn, buttons to push, places to go, people to kill.
Yeah, but that one was chock full of nostalgia.
Yeah, that's what that was.
That's where I keep that old lopped head around. It's a nice old three-knobber. You know, it's a shame them 441s don't come up for sale on eBay very often. See lots of 440s and 432s and 431s, but no 441s.
No, it seems to be a lot less of the 441s than some of the other models.
Hey, County, what's your 20?
Talking to you.
Who, me?
Countywide, what's your 20?
Northeast side of Pottstown, somewhere around Sanatoga.
Okay, yeah, Roger, we're neighbors then.
Yeah, where are you at?
Two blocks behind McDonald's on Mosier.
The McDonald's at the east end of Pottstown on Ridge Pike, High Street?
Yeah, on High Street, over by the hospital.
Yeah, I'm still a couple of miles away from there. Still north and to the east of that area.
Roger.
I'm off of Swamp Pike.
Hey, buddy, it's my neighbor tonight, and I'm 1,372 miles away.
And I did that drive in 23 hours. Yep, 23 hours from your house to my house without shutting the engine off.
I'll bet you that bike was as tired when you got home as you were.
I threw it in the garage, didn't look at it for a couple of weeks.
Nothing more on Gene, not even on Facebook or anything?
Sandbagger a couple weeks ago and I were having this discussion, and he, you know how he's good at turning over rocks on the internet. He was out there turning over rocks and he was unable to find any current trace of old 05.
Or maybe he's in greatest force.
I have to keep my eye open for him.
I think he's in West Virginia or something with his sister. Somewhere. He's last heard he was living with his sister, either Ohio or West Virginia or something like that.
Somehow life has its way of making its little turns and quirks, and you end up places according to the little things that you've done. You know, all the little options that you've chosen. If you press A, you will end up here. If you press B, you will end up here. If you press C, and you end up here. Specifications are subject to change, and all rights are reserved.
And if I can't talk skip, I'm going to drop them all day long. Hey, which reminds me, Sparky, were you ever able to identify that song?
Nah, I'd have to have, like, the whole clip. It was tough. It was in the background.
Are you still working on that project for me?
could. You're looking for a mic, right?
Raj.
Yeah, just got to get the box out. And I stand corrected. I'm not on a Golden Eagle 1. This one is just called the previous version, R27S23. They did make a Golden Eagle 68R and 68T, and I think maybe that's what Hammer's on or not, but there was 2 years there, 67, 68 for the brown and Golden Eagle Mark I, and these were between 64 and 66.
Face one with the other, you know, that little plug on the back, do they interface? I mean, is there no problem if you run one with the other?
The Mark II receiver will run with any of the transmitters prior to the Mark II. It won't run with the Mark III, and it won't run with a Mark IV transmitter, but it'll run with any of the transmitters from a Mark II previous. I've run this receiver with an S23 and it works just fine. This is a T68, which was the bridge the gap radio between R27S23, like Sparky's got there, and Mark II, Mark I, Mark II, same radio.
And the reason they called it the Golden Eagle, because that was the first one to have that brass eagle on the speaker grill. So now I'm short a Mark I series and a Mark II series.
It'd be nice if we had like the best of each manufacturer's, in other words, everybody's flagship. You know, whatever manufacturers you like. And you pick like maybe 5, 10, or 20 of them, and you get each one of their best.
Thought about trading Skeeter for his Mark II. He had that thing in the paper, and I guess not. He's already got a Mark III, though.
Mark II sound really nice. He was letting it go.
Shh.
That's my case. I'm never talking.
I just found an article. Well, actually, I found an old sales slip on the internet for the Mark 1. $359 back then.
To be a rich man.
No kidding.
That was a lot of money, man.
That was a heck of a lot of money. In some cases, too much pay for some folks.
Yeah, definitely a mortgage payment back then.
You had to really love CB radio to be able to cough up that kind of coin. I have a Hallicrafters General Coverage Receiver from 1954. Retailed for $1,000 in 1954. And it did not include a speaker.
That's extremely a lot of money, man. That was probably space age technology, man.
You didn't need a speaker. The wife would find out, she'd be yelling at you.
Well, that radio still performs today. I use it on HF AM all the time. But it had unheard of type coverage. It was 540 kilocycles to 56 megacycles in 6 bands. No gaps.
Good radio to me.
Stands up to my modern radio as far as sensitivity and selectivity. It just weighs a lot more.
All right, good circuitry. You can get yourself a decent shock down in there.
Oh, yeah, high voltage on board.
Hey, Sparky, I put my claws in one of those 23s, those Guardian 23s.
Not one of the two the guy had?
Yeah, the one that was unopened.
Well, you have to film that for YouTube, you know. Like the tram doctor does.
It was a little hard to resist that one. I appreciate the heads up. On the same token, I know I wasn't in the market for another radio, but man, how could you just watch it go by?
Well, you know, when you'd see that, it'd be that Canadian collector, that guy up there in Canada, and of course he has 5 of every radio ever made in a box, and you didn't have to hope, you know, it was half the price he'd charge.
That wasn't him, though. His name is Collectibles for You. That wasn't him. This was somebody totally different.
Yeah, it looked like they kind of got the buyout of a CB shop or found some guy who had a CB shop in the basement of his house or something, isn't it?
He must find one every year, then, because he always has something nice on there for years and years.
Okay, so he's another collector then. Well, that's cool. I just saw it. He had a real nice one. It was just out of the box. It looked the same, probably.
Pristine, man. And most everything he put on there, totally pristine. You know, top of the heap, you know, king of the hill.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I saw Utica Tiff 3 on there, too. Dirty, dirty, dirty. But there it was. It had a big tube in there.
I thought it was ugly. I saw that too. I'm thinking,
I like that Utica Town and Country.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about, the TC3.
I like it.
It's a nice piece, but you gotta catch it right.
The other one I'd like to get a hold of would be that Cardin Spitfire. but it was like a Canadian radio, but it's a Panasonic chassis.
Alright.
It's kind of like the Yellow Bird. Well, actually, more like the Green Bird.
Yeah, you know something? I have never found fault with those chassis. They're good radios. I don't know. It's like a Chevy or a Ford, you know what I mean? Middle of the line kind of thingy.
I like the idea that they were still making tube radios when everybody else gave it up for solid state. I mean, they still held on for a little while with multiple manufacturers putting them out right up into the 80s.
And then when they added the PLL underneath for the same hood as a tube radio, that wasn't a bad thought. You know, you still had your 40 channels and you didn't have to deal with crystals.
I have an example. It's Shakespeare 740. 40-channel PLL Panasonic tube chassis.
Roger. The only thing you got to worry about is keeping it nice and cool. You know, if you run them hard, sometimes that heat gets underneath it there and it does something to that PLL.
I always put an exhaust fan on top of my tube radios.
Like Maria and them is drifting into the background. We got our receive back.
I got my volume down because every time Sparky keys up, the dogs want to bark. She still looks at you.
Dirty looks better than no look.
That's right.
That's right. That's right. You know I moved there, don't you, Night Train? I'm down by the big city where the big boys play.
I heard. And so now you don't have the elevation anymore. Is this correct?
Hola, hola, Coca-Cola.
Been a long time since I've heard you, Ron.
I'm just laying back.
10-4, me too.
Antenna work and My now my legs are killing me.
Copy that. You sounded good too. Anyway, top of the day, 45, been a long time. You know who it is, I'm out here in the grass somewhere.
With those conditions, come on in here. We'll hook up then, huh?
That's for sure. It's been all southeast here. Southeast in Texas and west coast. I ain't had nothing out of the northeast for months.
Hey, Roger, on that. I talk all around the world on my little handheld walkie-talkie, and you can't even get conditions up the street.
Then there were crickets.
Specifications are subject to change without any prior written notice.
Seems to be a lot of changes going on.
Subject to change without any notice. See, I could tell you ahead of time, but then I'd have to kill you.
I used to have a top secret clearance. You can trust me.
Me too.
In God, I trust. All others pay cash.
Yeah, my squadron logo was, in God we trust, all others we monitor. I used to work on the U-2 reconnaissance plane.
Ah, the one that the Soviets have a copy of.
Yep.
Oops!
That was a lucky hit.
Then it got quiet again.
Oh, Sandbagger said he might be in later on.
I was wondering where he was.
Yeah, softball game somewhere.
That's
probably on his way back.
That softball rules that man's life. Today was good weather for it.
Yes, it was. That's why I couldn't give up the afternoon to go and work on the antenna. I had to go do it.
And you're the one that worked on the spy plane, you say?
Yeah.
Were you in the Air Force or something?
Used to be.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
My first home away from home was a building that moved and had an airport on the roof. Made 260,000 shaft horsepower.
Wow.
Just so we can point them into the wind and shoot them off with a catapult.
Yeah, my dad and my brother were Navy.
Yeah, my brother, my father, my grandfather were all U.S. Navy. And my great-grandfather was Royal Navy. Yeah, my family's history, at least on my father's side, during the Revolution, we were fighting for the other team.
Yeah, I did 15 years and injured my shoulder. And the Air Force said, you know what? We're doing force reduction. We're going to boot you out. So I left and now working at the state prison up at Graterford.
10-4 on a Graterford. Yeah, I did 10 active, 10 reserve. Because when Clinton came along, he basically made my job go away by getting rid of all the steamships. So I went into reserves and I've been working in a sort of a utility ever since, making steam and electricity. Still doing the same job, just the building don't move anywhere.
Yeah, roger that.
13.
My other grandfather on my mother's side retired from Graterford Prison in 1967. I got his gold watch. He was the food service department manager.
Oh, wow, that's pretty cool. Hey, we got a breaker in there. Go ahead.
No, I didn't break. I just jumped in here and said, hello, 13.
Howdy, Doug.
How you doing there, Pete?
How goes it, man? It's been a while.
Yeah, I'm telling you, man. Been working diligently on my bike, getting it ready for the summer.
Yeah. I put mine on the charger the other day, and now, you know, gave it its charge. Don't know if I'm going to be riding it or not.
Well, my bike came to me back in September with chrome lowers, and it's not stock for the application. So I brought them down to the dealership and had them rebuild them, and they confirmed that they, once they got into it, they realized that not only were they stock, but one of them was damaged. It appeared to be somebody that didn't know what they were doing, went in there and tried to get the retaining spring out with a screwdriver and scratched up the tube. So I ended up getting a new tube, but I'll tell you what, man, new forks, new rebuild forks, what a ride.
Yeah, that shit ain't cheap.
All right, question for you guys out there. I've got a cousin that lives up in Connecticut. I sent Sparky a message on this. He's got a 12-volt electrical system, and he's got a component. I'm not sure how much current it's going to draw, but he needs to get an electronic device that will drop 12 volts down to 0.01 to 0.09 volts, okay? And I don't know. I was thinking maybe like a variable resistor?
Probably too much current for something like that. An old school potentiometer might work, but then you got no regulation. My suggestion would be to build your own voltage regulator or come up with some kind of step down transformer voltage regulator or something along those lines. And but we're talking small current. If you're talking like 10 amps or something, I have to come up with a different solution. But for just an amp or two or three, I would build some sort of voltage regulator.
Yeah, I don't think he's gonna be running more than a couple amps, if more than one amp at all. I'm not sure what the current draw on this application is. I have very little information from what he's telling me.
Voltage regulator.
Yeah, I gotta have him send me a description of what he's trying to build and see if I can find out how much current it's going to draw before I start pushing them off in the wrong direction.
Voltage regulator, 3-tab voltage regulator. I got I got a part number of one here somewhere. Where you just you can make it any voltage you want, stepping down from 12 volts, and you just put in different resistors on the one leg. There's like there's plain old like 5-volt regulators and 9-volt regulators. This one's a variable, and it all depends on what resistance you put in there on the. I think it's the ground leg. I have to look for it. It's here somewhere. That would be your best bet. Sounds like you just need a voltage regulator.
Well, a voltage regulator take it from 12 down to 0.01 to 0.09?
0.01 volts? Man. Well, yeah, you could. It could be done, but 0.01 to 0.09, man, that's only less than a tenth of a volt. But yeah, a voltage regulator. Potentiometer ain't gonna do it.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I don't wanna hog up classic radio roundup, so I'm gonna back out of here and let the airwaves get back to where they were before I jumped in. Pete, it's been great talking with you. Maybe I'll catch up with you sometime this summer and out on the bikes.
Yeah, I put 1,500 miles on my bike in the last 2 years. I'm sort of lost interest for the time being because people keep trying to kill me.
Well, I got 500 on mine since September, but I really haven't gone very, I haven't really gone anywhere in the last couple of weeks, especially with the bike being down. So, all right, I'll be on the side. Thanks for the time in the air.
Yeah, you know, anytime. Stop by. Classic Radio Roundup, right here, Channel 13, Wednesday night, 27, 115 on EAM. Radio dial.
Catch you later, Badger.
I'll be back.
Hey, 10-4, yep, Spitfire, just that good. My sentiment's there on the switch.
Yeah, voltage regulation. I can't remember the part number of that particular variable one, but it's sort of a common part. You can, you know, search for it at Mauser or whatever. And I just don't remember the number of it, but depending on the resistance you put on the one leg, you can make it whatever voltage you want. You know, from 12 volts down to whatever.
I know. I always give the electronics 101 answer too. It was probably too long.
Guys, I'm going to have to say goodnight. I got to leave 4 o'clock in the morning, so I'm going to hit the sack.
Well, glad to have you for the time that we did have you. Night train, your countywide radio to Spitfire.
Yeah, Roger, right on.
See you, train.
All right, good, Brandon. Doc Hammer, if you're still there. Good night, train. Hey, good night. Yeah, I gotta go. Wish I could stay and play, but, you know, 4 o'clock will be here so fast.
All right, train. You have a good night. Safe work tomorrow.
Funny thing is, when you're up all night, though, 4 o'clock gets here really slow, because that's lunchtime.
10-4. So I should be out there when you're having your lunch. 10-4?
10-4. All right there, train. Have yourself a good night, and catch you soon.
Roger that, old train. We're going 10-7.
Night, train.
Night, dear. Rick, man, I'll tell you, I hate to do it, but I gotta go.
Well, now you know how I feel every day.
Yeah, man. All right, I'm hitting it.
Have a good one. Hello, radio.
Hello, radio.
Hey, there's Ken.
Yep, that's me. Hey, Spitfire.
441. You have to ask my Indian belly dancer.
Oh, okay. Never mind.
Go ahead. I was just trying to be a little silly.
Do they still use minesweepers in the Navy?
There's a question I'm not sure of the answer of. In my time, yes. Whether they're still out there, I do not know. My best guess is yes, they're still out there, but probably not all that many. Wouldn't hold ships.
Now, when my dad was in the Navy, they first put him on a minesweeper, and then they transferred him to installing all the electronics on P3Cs.
Them P3s are great anti-submarine warfare platform. Used to fly them out of Willow Grove. Not me personally, but that's where they flew out of. But I would have to say that there's probably still minesweepers in the service. Because I can't imagine ever a time being when they're not needed.
Yeah, I hear that one.
But they do have wooden hulls and a lot of brass fittings. Very little iron on them boats. Yeah, belly dancers. That's another name for naval maneuvers.
Copy that.
Oh, man!
What'd you do?
It is what it is. On Classic Radio Roundup. For more information, write to P.O. Box 88, Moscow, Russia. No,
That's about 2 feet away on a D-104.
Sounds good.
This is the Gemtronics.
Solid state or tube?
Solid state.
Still sounds good. And nobody else could hear you.
Yeah, but now we've upgraded.
Yeah, Pool Skimmer 2000. Yep. If I didn't know better, I'd think my antenna was disconnected.
I was thinking the same thing, but I went from like 3 pounds to next to nothing.
Yeah, I got nothing. Silence. even turn the preamp on. Oh, there's a little static there.
Yeah, well, usually I hear the warehouse, but I don't even hear the warehouse.
I don't hear the Delco boys anymore. They packed it in, I guess. Maybe they went back to 15.
Yeah, they got that train noise down there. It dries them out.
For me, it's refill the coffee cup time. I'll be back. Carry on with classic radio roundup.
I'm back. I'm working on my number four over here.
We're on the video gate.
Gates are rolling.
And when I say number four, those are my Captain and Coke 50-50s.
Hey, Badger, did you drink one for me the other day?
Actually, I drank about three more.
Oh, good. So you had an extra one for me, then?
Absolutely.
I appreciate
it. No problem, man. More than happy to drink for anybody.
Well, it must have worked because it was a nice, quiet night that night.
Yes.
Yes, what?
Yes means that it works.
I was in Elizabeth, New Jersey today, threading the eye of a needle with a 48-foot tanker.
Oh, yeah? Was it power lines or just structural avoidance?
I had 10 feet, the trailer's 8 feet wide. I had 10 feet between a telephone pole and a gas pipe that came up out of the ground. And then alongside the gas pipe was a concrete building. And at the back corner of the concrete building, 12 feet from the concrete building, was another gas line that came up. And I had probably about 40 feet between the telephone pole and some fixed objects on the other side of the park, on the other side of the dirt parking lot. And I put that 45-foot trailer in that hole with a tractor with a sleeper on it.
Did you have a straight shot, or did you have to curve it in?
Man, I'm telling you. They got two silos and a control office. And in front of the control office, they've got two, like, 5,000-pound generators on twin-axle trailers. And when I started backing up, I had to hang real close, within 2 inches of one, in order to start getting the angle on the trailer. And then I got within about a foot of the telephone pole and just started jacking it around. The problem was, every time I went to follow the trailer, the nose of the tractor kept on getting really close to the fixed objects that were on the other side of the dirt parking lot. So basically what I ended up doing is I ended up cutting the wheel of the tractor really hard to the left. It, like, jackknifed the tractor to the left. And then started opening up the angle of the truck and the trailer as I pushed it back further. So it took me like 15, 20 minutes to put it in. But the nice thing about it is I had three very skilled ground keepers keeping an eye on me at three different points on the truck and the trailer. So basically what I was doing is I was using my best judgment on what I had to do in order to get the trailer in the hole, but I was using these guys as visuals to let me know when I was running out of room in all the other areas that I couldn't see. So, I mean, without their help, I couldn't have done that. I am just absolutely amazed that I was able to get this thing into that little hole. The hole was probably like about 60 feet long, but at one point in between the telephone pole and one of the gas pipes, it was only 10 feet wide. So it really, you know, I was very happy those guys were there to help me get that thing in.
Well, those ground people are, you know what, they help you see what you can't see.
Absolutely.
You can't see I ain't got no panties on.
No, come on.
You talking about scrubbing out one of those containers with your Brillo pad that made me think the other day we got a new mattress. I was like, oh, now I know what happens to the old ones.
Yeah, well, that's how I clean the cans out. Instead of using the fingers to scrape anything, what I do is I get an old chain link fence and about a dozen mattresses, and when they get down to the box or, you know, to the springs, that makes the perfect rub out tool. So I call it the Brillo.
Gorilla Brillo or something. You should patent that and sell it to companies for doing it, who do cleanup, you know, when they want to just scour the pad, they're done, all the rest.
Well, I tell you what, it comes in handy in the wintertime, and even when there's like glue on the floor or paint or something like that, the guys always ask me to clean it out without them having to wash it. So they come over and I give them a little scrub up and down, and like a pan, it's clean.
That's cool, man. You have to capture a video of that for us at some point. It would be awesome. Give it to Night Train or something. He'll forward it.
Be at 10-4.
I mean, unless it's like a trade secret or something, then I understand.
Well, I'm not going to say that it's a trade secret now. It's just something that I found that works without having to put the fingers on the cans, because you never know where the holes are in the bottom of some of these cans. They're not all brand new, so some of these old dumpsters are really beat up. I had just gotten my machine back. They just did the fingers and the fingernails and all that stuff, so I was trying to save on the fingernails. And I try not to touch the ground. I try not to scrape the floor. I like to keep them square and nice and clean, so.
Yeah, it's a fun job. I got a little backhoe. It's fun. Even that thing's fun. I can imagine that times 10. I got to run a big loader, a big John Deere loader, when I was 15 years old. That was a cool job, man. Just filling gravel.
Well, I like payloaders, and I like loaders and stuff like that. I like track loaders. But when I stepped up to the excavator, it was just like a third hand, you know. You just, I don't know, you start to pinch things and see what you can pick up off the floor.
There was a cute video on Facebook the other day. It was a dad made this cardboard suit to look like a Mechatron robot with big giant guns on each hand, big machine guns, and a little baby was poised in the center, like housed in like a little, you know, holster. And the dad made this silver cardboard thing he was wearing it around and made the baby look like some big mech assault baby.
Power Ranger baby.
Yeah, DJ.
Yeah, it was pretty neat.
Sitting around getting fat, huh? You gonna be awake till 11? I'll see you then.
I'm gonna have some seat time. I gotta dig a stump out there by the mailbox. She said, dig it out.
Big one?
Nah, it's like a 12-inch cedar stump that's been sitting there, you know, rotting real nice. Cedar, they still hold into the ground. And we're going to get some gravel delivered, so it's spring cleanup time. Are you ready?
Pretty much.
How about the bug spray? You got the permethrin? Do around your foundation?
No, I didn't do that yet. They sent out a newsletter for Limerick about this moth. I guess it's a moth, and it's been laying eggs in hard fruit trees or something like that. I forget what they call it, though.
Lantern fly?
I can't remember what it was called, but they say it's laying, like, eggs in trees and stuff like that. Right now is the best time to get them so they don't reproduce.
Yeah, all my trees are like 125 feet, so I'd need a really big bucket truck.
That's right.
Was there a breaker out there?
I just said that's right.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, hopefully I can get out there with my bow and arrow and string some string for some wire antennas before the leaves come out. I plan on doing that every year and it never seems to happen. The weather is all crappy and then the leaves are there. I need some nice weather before the leaves come.
I'd like to try and do it with a drone.
Yeah, that might be tricky around here. But yeah, a good drone, you could put it right where you want. I think with a bow and arrow I'll be all right.
Some line so thin, like 4-pound or 1-pound test, that would the rotors wouldn't get tangled in it. It would have to snap it. It'd have to be like a wet noodle.
You just get a bigger drone and heavier line and keeps it below the rotors.
Yeah, zero wind day.
Have a 1-ounce weight or something like that on it with a quick release. You know, you get it up and over where you want and then release it.
WMMR weather forecast says all gray.
Yeah, tomorrow's not going to be a nice day.
Good weather for 2 weeks now. No sunshine at all.
rain we had last week kind of put a hamper on opening day.
I just figured the trout were washed way down.
Believe it or not, they stay in their holes, but I guess some go downstream, but I'll tell you what, the creeks are actually down right now, but they ain't gonna be down tomorrow.
They weren't down the other day.
No, they look like a chocolate frothy.
Yeah, my Babbling Brook, you could have taken a kayak down.
Yeah, I come over Germantown Pike Bridge Saturday, and it was pretty muddy still down there. I didn't see that many cars down in that lot.
Sanatoga Creek starts in my backyard.
Chuck, Chuck.
What's that humpback bridge over there in Collegeville?
That's the Perky Omen.
Yeah, okay, I've crossed that a couple times. Taking some product up there to Hatfield. I don't see any weight limit on that bridge, though.
That bridge is old. That thing was built in, like, the 18th century or some shit.
Older than dirt.
80,000.
Yeah, it takes both lanes for me to make those curves heading east.
Yeah, and then going west, you're in the other guy's lane coming.
I don't come back that way. I don't know why. It's normally they send me out to Evansville, which is north of Redding, up on 222 and 73. So from Hatfield, I get on 309, head up to 78, and head over to 222.
Wednesday night's TV night for Quarter Wave Dave.
He's an
Sorry about that, Badger. I got a little click on the mic there. Yeah, so I've been off for 30 minutes now. I got 30 mic come over by the radio.
No, I've been walked on before, no big deal.
I think we've all had our turn at that.
Even Doc Hammer.
Night Train was out here earlier, even.
He's in bed by now. He gets up too early.
Yep, he is, but he was here. Wrench was here. I don't know, he still might be.
The cat survivor, Doc Hammer.
I talked on the radio too. I had my chair sitting over here in the door of the kitchen where I could see better.
night.
Yeah, it was a pretty good episode. Pretty good episode. We'll see what happens next week. Next week ought to be pretty wild. If tonight is any example, next week's going to be something else.
For I thought for sure Ty would get voted off and not play his immunity idol.
Catch you later, Air Quarter Wave, Dave.
See you, Dave.
Have a good night, neighbor.
Check, check.
The leader of China is down there in Florida. I think my Harbor Freight tool prices are about to go up.
Six or seven hours on a full tank, and
those. They're like super tiny little lightweight ones, yeah. I looked at that one. I looked at the little four-stroke model, too. I'd really like, because I have generators, but they're heavy, man. Some of them, you gotta lift like a crane type of thing.
Yeah, I have a 2,500-watt four-stroke generator. Had a Honda engine on it. Good generator, ran great, but man, it was noisy. I could put it around on the other side of the truck, you know, a good 50, 60 feet away from the camper, and I could still hear that thing run. This little thing, you start it up, and you could sit it on the tailgate of the truck, or in the bed of the truck, or on the other side on the ground, and you can't hear it. It's real well muffled. And, of course, a muffled two-cycle just don't make that much noise.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's what my buddy's getting, a Honda inverter set up. I had an inverter generator. It was a Generac, and it caused a lot of radio noise, but that thing gave me, you know, a fair amount of lifespan before it died.
Yeah, I have, like I said, I have two Honda 2000s, and they're hooking together, and I can get 4,000 out of
them. 10-4, yeah. Good to hear you out there, Silver Bullet, up there in Ole. Man, quite a few check-ins tonight.
On Classic Radio Roundup.
Yeah, who would have thunk?
Brig.
Hey, Brigger.
Hey, it's Wrench. I'm turning in for now, so I'll catch you guys on the other side.
All right, Wrench. Catch you later.
Have a good night, Wrench.
Guys, too. I'll catch you tomorrow.
Catch you later there, Wrench. County Wad.
Roger, 10-4. Have a good night.
Footwell up to the batteries. And a Dodge crew cab, the long bed.
About eight feet, 8 to 10.
It might be longer, it might be more. That's a long truck, man. I can check though, I'll look at that though.
Take a piece of rope. Run the piece of rope for you, and you gotta run that wire.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
What are you powering up, an amp?
I wanna have a nice drop, a power drop from the batteries. I got two batteries, and bring them to the back seat where I can have a distribution type of panel there and run an amp or my inverter or whatever.
Yeah, I want to Audio Sensations over here in North Coventry, and they ran two pieces of heavy wire. I think they were number four wire or something like that. It was definitely overkill for what I had in mind. But I've got 80 amps of service right inside the center console of my minivan.
Now that's what I'm talking about, Will.
Four pill.
Yeah, the nice thing about it is I brought the cables in, and then I tied them into their own fuse blocks. So the positive has five fuses, and the negative also has five fuses as well.
Ah, very nice. Yep, I just want to get some back in there. I'll check it out, Ranger. I think it's more. I could swear it's more. It's like 15 feet or something. I think the truck's like 20-some foot long.
Can you give me an overall length to shoot for? Because I did come across a couple tens, but if that ain't long enough, I can look for something else.
Hey, 10-4, I set aside that repeat module. I found two buttons, a red and black button. And then you're going to need to get some phono plugs, 8-inch phono plugs off of Amazon or whatever.
Yeah, 10-4. That ought to drive people crazy.
The thing that's cool about the repeat thing is if you get the cables made up, you can record anything you want on there. And you can change it, whatever.
Yeah, there's a couple little red wagons I want to fix. That one guy did get quiet. I can hear him. He keys up every once in a while, but he don't do that same stuff that he was doing.
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't have been the only guy noticing that.
Yeah, well, I exposed him a couple times, and I had people on the ear out for him. I pretty much pinpointed him.
Shocked and amazed when they're exposed.
Guys, we're gonna step out of here. You guys have a good night. 73's to you. Be safe now.
Good night, Ranger.
Have a good night there, Ranger.
All right, catch you later, Ranger.
Yeah, 410.
Ah, yes.
That's what she said last night.
Now my boys come in from time to time and we discuss whatever logistics is going on. I think it's really nice that people keep their, you don't have to say it anymore. People keep their, keep the cursing out and stuff. It's really nice. Luxury. is, Doc Hammer. My radio's still working. I always pray to the radio gods. Keep working. Into the trams lately. I sort of like focused on the Brownings and got a few of them resurrected, but I put another setup of the 2723 to see if I could get that running tonight. Probably could have, I just couldn't stand the crackle there. But I haven't really looked much into the trams. Watch them on the YouTube videos, and they just go and they replace every cap. You know what I mean? They're just like, before I even look at this thing, we're just going to shotgun this right off the bat with caps.
I've been doing that with my broadcast radio restorations. Really not that many electrolytics in them, so just go through and replace them all. That 1931, there's the filter caps in there. One microfarad on either side of a 24 Henry choke. So I ordered some non-electrolytic 1.5 microfarad caps. These things are the size of a D battery.
Yeah, they go for a couple bucks each, too.
Yeah, they're big.
You know, we're talking about the electrolytic caps, not the disc caps. They're usually pretty good.
No, I understand, but I'm talking about not even disc caps. They're not electrolytics, but they're not, you know, I don't know, I guess they are. They're polypropylenes or whatever. But you can use those to replace electrolytics. It doesn't have to be an electrolytic. Anyway, I went with those. Why did I go with those? Because I couldn't find the value I wanted in electrolytic, maybe. But in any case, that was a tip from Sandbagger. I can use them, so I stuck them in there. Polypropylene plastic, whatever, 630 volt rating, 1.5 microfarad. Things are like big. Electrolytics, you know, are a lot smaller.
Okay, yeah, they weren't polarity sensitive.
No, but it was. I'm assuming an electrolytic that I replaced. It's kind of hard to tell. It was sort of like, you know, we're talking 1931 technology here. It was this big rectangular can with five capacitors in it. I just bypassed that and put in the five individual caps.
Yeah, leave the can in there, make it look good, do it all underneath. That's the way to go.
That's right. There was one standalone electrolytic in there. It was labeled 1/2 microfarad, you know, 1/2 instead of a 0.5. Like, oh man, this is early days radio here. We called it a half a microfarad.
Yeah, and then if you get into the big power, then you'll have those doorknob caps, actually called doorknob capacitor. And they're like a disc cap, and you gotta look for cracks in them.
Oh, I'm familiar with doorknob caps. They're used in amplifiers and different places. Oh, yeah. Yeah, me and one of them had a run-in before. Replaced it with a Soviet-made doorknob cap for that particular application, because it was the only voltage and value I could find at the time on the flea bay.
Ah, yeah, there's guys making amps there now. They put them on eBay. Russian tubes.
Yeah, while we went solid state, they were still using vacuum tubes.
Oh, I'd bet money they're probably still using vacuum tubes.
Oh, yeah.
Guys, it's almost 10 o'clock. I'm pulling the plug. You always have a good one. You guys win the contest. You know. Happy Channel 13. Been a pleasure to be on the Classic Radio Roundup. Have a good night.
Have a good night there, Badger. Thanks for checking in. Classic Radio Roundup. Take care there, Dr. Hammer. Glad you could join us tonight on Classic Radio Wednesday, and we'll catch you next week. Countywide. Well, since everybody's fading away, I think I'm going to fade away myself and catch you all later. 7-3, and thanks for the fun on Classic Radio Wednesday.